Welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of Teaching and Vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicago. And I'm your host, Wesley Casford. I don't know where Tommy is.
Wesley, that has got to be the most lively I've ever heard you speak.
Yeah, I really turned it on sometimes.
Look at you.
It's
great. Time for the radio voice for Wesley Casford.
Sometimes I don't see it coming. That's why it works.
Okay.
So today, we have a guest. But before that, we'd like to have a little conversation. Typically, you and Tommy. I'm not sure where he is.
Yeah, we got that part. I don't know where Tommy is either. Yeah. I think he's just with his family today.
Yep.
He's just decided that it was this was beneath him.
More people should do that. The first part, the former.
Oh, the thing with this the family. Is beneath them?
Yeah, no, be with the family.
Don't worry. I think our listener numbers are low enough to give evidence that a lot of people think this is beneath them.
That's fine. But our guest today loves books, but I think that I have talked with you in the past. You don't love books.
What?
Like just for fun. You don't
What
read,
are you talking about?
Do you read books for fun? Like fiction.
Fiction.
Yeah.
Fiction. No.
Yep.
I have to be honest, I find fiction to be sometimes a waste of time.
Right.
And that's dumb because I like storytelling, all of that sort of thing. But I always feel guilty when I'm reading a fiction book. It might be because I read mostly Harlequin when I read fiction. Wesley, I'm kidding. I don't read Harlequin at all. I just look at the covers.
Yeah, there you go.
I don't do that either. But I'm telling you that I don't know what it is that's inside of me that says, look, if you're going to be spending time reading something, it should be something that is super profitable and all that kind of thing, which is such a dumb view because some of the best books in the history of the world were fiction.
I have a similar feeling, but about other things.
Yeah.
I do like books, but I do know that you enjoy music.
I do.
And
I have an eclectic taste in music.
Yes.
Mostly.
So I was thinking you could tell us all some music, like, what am I trying to say? Music that is, people should give a try. Give a little.
Really?
You know, something that.
Okay. So
interesting things that you're like, you know what? People should listen to this.
So here's what I've done over the years. Yep. It used to be that you went with bands. And I think this is a common thing for a lot of people now, that people would go with a band that they loved. But now they don't do that as much. They go with songs that they love.
Yep.
Because it used to be the case that you had to buy the whole album.
It's true.
And now you can pick and choose the songs that you like. Okay. So I don't even know. You might know this. When a band puts together an album, are they? Do they think through like how one song leads to the next still? Because that used to be the way that they do it.
A lot do.
You know, like, they're kind of telling a story through the whole album type thing.
Yeah, a lot still do.
Okay.
Some don't.
Because that's a bit of a dated idea. And it's based on the idea that here's a whole album and you're going to listen to the whole of it.
Yep.
But most people don't do that
right
these days. They just listen to a song that they might like or not like and that sort of thing. So I now have my own playlists that... Actually, I have one playlist that's got 400 or 500 songs on it, so it's not really useful at all.
Is that the Funky Fresh?
Yeah, I got two different Funky Fresh mixes.
Yep.
So one's called Dad's Hard to Kill Funky Fresh Mix, and then I have another Hard to Kill Funky Fresh Mix.
Good.
That's titled Another Hard to Kill Funky Fresh
Revenge.
Mix.
Yep. Revenge of the Funky Fresh.
So I can tell you a couple songs that I've been interested in lately.
Yep. Some sleepers.
Okay, so one is by a woman named Ally Sherlock. Do you know who Ally Sherlock is?
I don't.
I'm looking around the room. Nobody knows? Dude, I am so cutting edge.
Are you? You are.
Lewis knows who Ally Sherlock is.
You're setting the trends.
Because she's Irish.
Okay.
And she kind of got her gig through singing on the street.
Okay.
And she's got a beautiful voice. And she started singing a song... I think she just wrote it and performed it called How Love Works. That's quite nice.
Okay.
It's a very nice song. It's Adele-ish.
Okay.
So if you like Adele, you really would like Ally
kind
Sherlock.
Kind of a ballad.
Yeah, but she's mostly done covers in the past, and this one is the first time I've actually heard her sing her own stuff.
Okay.
But it's a very nice song.
Okay.
And I like it. And I was listening to it on the plane the other day, thinking, oh, it's very nice. I am a big fan of Switchfoot. Okay. Have been for years.
All right.
Mostly because if you give me a driving guitar, I'm in.
Okay.
I think the church needs more driving electric guitar.
We'll let them know.
Do you know what I mean? Yep. More aggressive driving guitar.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
So back in the 80s, I liked the driving guitar. Any song that had a driving guitar. Do you know who Whitesnake is?
Yes.
Yeah? Here I go again on my own. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Yeah. See, driving guitar in that. I came to realize a number of years ago that all the songs that I liked the most had driving guitar in them. And I was like, oh, okay.
Oh,
that is my problem.
Okay.
Yeah. So when you two, a number of years ago, did How to Dismantle an Atomic Bomb, I really liked that album because it basically is just the Edge just playing his guitar loud.
Yeah.
And I liked it a lot. I just thought that was great.
Okay.
In fact, U2's got a couple of songs that I listened to recently that came out that I thought were really good. You are the, what is the one that they call? You are the
ones they put on your phone. They put on everyone's phone.
The solution to the problem or something like that.
Thank you.
That's the name of the song. I can't remember what it's called. Wesley, who's your favorite band? You seem like the kind of guy who would really dig weird indie bands, and then the moment they became even remotely famous, you would have this short period of time where you told everybody you liked them before anyone else did, and then you would hate them because they're now sellouts.
I do feel that way often.
Okay.
I do also ride a lot of the popular trains, but I do like having eclectic taste for sure. My favorite band is called Kroonbin.
Kroonbin.
Kroonbin. It's a Thai word, I believe, that means airplane.
Oh. Is it a Thai band?
They're all American, but they are based on Thai funk. So it's kind of a Thai, it's like psychedelic funk.
Do we call this cultural appropriation?
I don't think so.
No?
It's funk that was
Seems culturally appropriation-ish.
You use that word. They also sing in Spanish. It's very...
But they're it's an American band.
They're American. All right. It's very, very good. It's very... you could listen to it anytime.
All right.
Anything. They've really soundtracked my life in the last few years.
Okay.
You know, the bands kind of just...
Did they know you?
Not custom, but you know.
Oh, okay.
That's when I listen to these songs.
That would be interesting to soundtrack your life.
That would be nice. Yeah. Kind of a Truman Show, but I know about
it. Sufjan Stevens probably soundtracked your life at some point.
Maybe. That would be nice. He's very
You know what I mean? Really mellow,
yeah, he's
slow.
Very gifted. Yeah. And then random crazy bits.
Yes.
I do enjoy Kroonbin. The other thing I really enjoy, it's very strange, but I enjoy mid-century lounge music.
Which century?
The 1900s. So like you got kind of the Muzak sound, and then you've also got Exotica, which sounds dirty, but it's actually just Brazilian and like kind of Spain influenced jazz and soundtrack kind of. It's maybe what you'd hear in like a tiki bar. It's a very interesting. Spotify does a thing.
All my time in tiki bars. I'm trying to remember what music was playing.
Yeah, on the jukebox.
Do you know what the tiki room is?
Oh, of course. Disney World.
Have you ever heard the song from the tiki room?
Yeah, of course. In my house right now, we have a letterboard.
I brought this up the other day with someone and they didn't know the tiki room song.
Oh, no. In my house right now, we have a letterboard and it says, my siestas keep getting shorter and shorter.
Oh, yeah. Nice. The birds sing the words.
We're right into the Disney World.
Okay.
Just like our guest today. How about that? She worked at Disney World.
She did not.
Yes, she did.
That is a lovely transition. And that you immediately have piqued my interest.
Yep, there you go.
She worked at Disney World. We're going to find out what princess she was.
Yeah, well, she was a type of prince. Well, I'll let her fill you in on that. But we're going to talk to Sam Strawn today, who's on staff here, works with Harvest Kids. And we do that because we believe everybody's got a story. And we're going to get into it right now. Let's go. We miss you, Tommy. Come back.
sitting across from Sam Strawn.
Hello.
S-T-R-A-W-N. Yes. I just learned. Because I thought it was Sam Strong for a while there. And now everybody, I've been dissuaded from believing this.
Most people do. And that's why I say it's the drinking straw with an N at the end. Okay. That's how it's spelled.
Sam Strawn.
Okay,
Sam, I'm gonna start with something I usually want to find out obviously all about your childhood and all of how you became the person that you are today. But before we do that, I have a feeling, and I've been told that you have one of the richest work histories that around. So let's do a little game.
Okay.
Let's go from the beginning of your work experience till now. Okay. What have you done? What kinds of work have you done?
Okay. My first job, well, I worked two jobs when I started working. I was about 15. I worked at a hair salon as a shampoo girl. I did not want to go into hair.
Wait a minute. What?
Yeah. So I was paid.
That's a thing?
That was a thing. Yeah.
So if I go to like a girl's hair salon, there's a special person who does your hair, your shampoo?
Sometimes. Yeah. And that was me. I was like 15, 16.
That's a made up job.
Well, I didn't get paid a lot, so. Kind of.
Do they tip the shampoo girl?
Yes, they do.
What?
Yeah.
How many people are they tipping in the women's hair thing?
I mean, the salon I worked at had a lot of regulars, so it was a lot of the old ladies that came in once a week because that was the only time they got their hair done and did anything to their hair, so they'd give me like a dollar.
Nice.
Yeah. They're like, don't spend it all in one place. I was like, totally. I will.
I don't think that's possible to not spend it in one.
Yeah.
So a shampoo girl?
Yeah. So then at the same time, I was also working at a winery.
Did you ever like mix those two jobs? Because you could have either washed hair in wine. You could have drunk the wine before you washed the hair.
I didn't because, again, I was 16. Okay. So I worked in the kitchen at the winery.
So it was a food like you came to eat at the winery.
Kind of. Yeah. You could like order some stuff.
Yeah. What kinds of stuff did you do in the kitchen?
I would put together like little charcuterie boxes. I would make cheese boards and flatbreads when they had them.
So you're the one who cut the cheese.
Yep. That was me.
You see what I did there?
Yes, but my mom worked there. She started there when I was one. So I grew up in the place. So they threw me everywhere. They called me the guinea pig because they could just have me. They were like, hey, can you go do this? And I was like, I think so.
Wow.
Yeah. I did tours a couple times without ever.
Where was this?
It's in Roselle.
Okay.
So it's still there.
Winery in Roselle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That was a fun one.
And then?
I worked at a train station for a bit.
Doing what?
I sold coffee to morning commuters. I had like a little cart.
Like an outside cart?
Yeah. There was a little cafe there. But then if people just wanted like black coffee with cream, they could come over to my cart and get coffee. That was short-lived, but
why?
I was accused of stealing from the cafe.
Oh, did you?
No.
You sure?
I'm positive.
You didn't just one day take a couple sips of the old black coffee and
I didn't drink coffee yet.
Oh, okay.
I didn't drink coffee until
why did they accuse you of stealing from the cart?
Because they didn't want to pay me what they were paying me, so they were trying to find a way to get me to not work there anymore.
Nice. And the old accusation of theft.
The awkward part was my boss was my neighbor. So I still had to see him after that. I was like, oh, hello.
You should have just taken the cart home.
Well.
And said, and then they said, but you stole. No, I didn't. Yeah. Just keep it in front of your house.
I also was still working at the winery at the time. So I was like, whatever.
Okay. Keep going.
After that, I'm trying to think of where I went after that. I worked at Old Navy. For a stint.
What did you do at Old Navy?
Everything.
So is that that's the gig at Old Navy? They don't hire like specialists. It's a general retail
thing. It wasn't supposed to be.
Do they have like backroom folding type folks and then they have the cashiers or does everybody do?
Yeah. So because I still have a hard time saying no to things sometimes. They were like, hey, can you also do
can I borrow $100
and also do... I am so poor. No.
Okay. Clearly, it's not that hard.
Well, now.
Go ahead. All right.
I did a lot of things and would work like 14-hour shifts.
Yeah.
And half of them would be overnight, which was not good because I was 17. So it was actually, I wasn't supposed to do that, but I did.
Okay.
It was fine. And then I graduated high school and went away for a year.
That's a lot of high school work you just did.
Yes.
Okay.
I also started my own cleaning business for a hot second that I just remembered now.
You did?
Yeah, because I didn't want to get a real job when my parents told me I had to. And I was like, I'll just have a cleaning business.
Did it ever result in cleaning stuff?
I had a couple houses that I cleaned, yeah.
Okay.
And then I realized I didn't like cleaning other people's houses.
How long did it take before you realized that your love of cleaning did not extend into other people's messes?
It was about two houses.
Okay.
And I was like, I don't like this.
This is not the business.
I'll go get a new job.
Okay.
Came back. Where did I work? Oh goodness. I worked at a barbecue restaurant for a little bit. And then I
was doing what?
I was just at a counter. And then I did the deep fryer.
Oh, the deep fryer. Yeah,
they gave me zero training and they were like, fry things. I said, okay. And I just figured it out.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if I would be able to figure that. I think you just dump it in there.
Yeah, pretty much.
Wait till it beeps and you bring it out.
But you really have to make sure you put it in a basket, because if you let chicken tenders just kind of float around, then it's really hard to get them because it's hot oil.
That's true.
Yeah. And then I worked here for a couple years.
Here at Harvest?
Mm-hmm. I was a receptionist for a couple years.
Okay.
And then I decided to go back to college. And while I was there, I was still working at the winery. I worked at the winery for 9 years.
Oh, wow.
And then while I was in college, I got a job with the Bulls. So I worked for the Bulls for a season and a half.
Doing what?
I was the 50-50 raffle seller.
So what did that entail? Did you have a booth or did you walk around?
I walked around.
And yelled 50-50?
Uh-huh. I had a huge sign. It was very heavy. And walking up and down the stairs at the United Center was a workout.
Really? Mm-hmm. Yelling 50-50?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I loved it. I met a couple like retired basketball players, so that was really fun, including Scottie Pippen, which was
great. Was he a big 50-50 guy?
He didn't buy any, but he was very pleasant to have a conversation with.
Oh, nice.
I didn't realize it was him, though, when I was talking to him, so that was womp-womp for me. And then from that job, I got a job at the Cubs, so I worked for the Cubs for...
Doing what?
50-50.
See?
Yep.
He had a niche market now.
I did, yeah. But I was a supervisor for a year, which
there's
was
a supervisor
fun.
For 50-50?
Mm-hmm. There's a supervisor
for every
department.
How many people are involved in the 50-50 racket?
For the Cubs, there was like
30 sounds like a,
employees.
Sounds like a pyramid scheme now.
Well, you know.
So there's... Okay, so you supervised other people who were selling the 50-50.
Yes.
Got it.
That was the last year I worked for them. And then I also worked for the Bears. For a season.
Like that one as much?
No, not really.
Why not?
It was fan services, and I was essentially just a glorified like bathroom sign telling people where the bathrooms were.
Really?
Yeah. And I also wasn't allowed to watch the games. If I was caught watching the games, then I would get in massive trouble.
Can I just tell you something? I've watched the Bears. There wasn't anything you missed.
No. It was Matt Nagy's final season.
See,
too,
I'm just telling you, at that point, you should just be like, I didn't want to watch him anyway.
Yeah, it was real tough. I did want to watch it because I just love football, but I was like, I don't really want to be here right now. I don't want to be associated. What else did I do?
I'm waiting for Disney World.
Oh, yeah, Disney World. I did work at Disney World, yes.
What did you do at Disney World?
I was a park greeter at the Magic Kingdom.
A park greeter.
Yeah.
What does that do? What do you do as a park greeter?
I stood there while people scanned in their tickets and made sure they got in with actual tickets.
So did you were you kind of police-ish then?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There were people that tried to sneak in all the time.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Were you good at finding them?
Yeah, they were very obvious.
How?
Well, they'd come up and be like, I left my ticket in the car. I'm like, oh, well, they're on your phone. And they were like, oh, well, my phone's in the car. I said, cool, you can go to guest services. They were like, can't you just let me in? I said, no, I cannot.
No.
And then most of the time they would try and walk in through the exits. And then we'd be like, security.
Really?
Right there. Mm-hmm. There was one guy that was, I'll never forget him. He wore a bright white fedora with a yellow feather in it. I was like, if you're going to try and sneak in, at least be a little more inconspicuous. Like,
yeah.
That stands out.
How many people successfully sneak into I don't know why my mind is saying Wonder World. Disney World.
Great question. I don't actually know because we tried to catch as many people as we could. So if I didn't catch them, then probably a few, but not at Magic Kingdom.
Okay.
There were.
Is it harder to get into Disney World or the United States border?
I am not
probably Disney World, right?
Probably. Okay. Probably. If you know the right people, you probably can get in.
Okay.
But I don't speak.
Did you get special deals?
Oh yeah.
Being part of Disney World. Did you have could you get free admission and stuff?
I had free admission. Yeah. I had a card that let me go in and out whenever I wanted.
Oh wow.
Well, most of the time.
Why were you, so you were in Orlando though. Why were you there? To work at Disney World?
Yeah. I did the Disney College program. So I graduated college in 2021 and then my parents took me to Disney as my graduation trip and they were like, you should apply for the college program.
There's a college program at Disney?
Mm-hmm.
What is that?
It's essentially a way for kids that are in college or just graduated college to have an internship on their resume.
Oh.
Because you do not make a lot of money.
So you just go and work there?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah. I had a great time.
Were you ever tempted to become a princess?
So fun fact, I am both too tall and too short to be any character at Disney.
What?
Yeah. The requirements for the princesses are, it's 5'1" to 5'7".
Really?
And then for all the other characters, it's 6 foot to 6'3", and I am 5'9".
Really?
So, mm-hmm.
There's not a princess over 5'7"?
Nope.
Wow.
Yeah, you're getting all the inside scoop.
Okay. What are the things about Disney that we don't know? Give me some behind the scenes. Oh. What's going on behind the scenes where it says cast only? What is that? Is there big parties happening back there?
Gosh, I wish. It's just a lot of dumpsters and cast members that are just lounging on tables because they're tired. And
yeah,
it's Florida.
Yeah, I bet. So. I would never, being one of the characters, especially in inside the suits, that would be hard.
Oh yeah.
In the middle of the summer in Orlando.
That was something I got to see one of the cast members that played Mickey take the head off. And I was like, whoa. Is this going to ruin the magic for me? It didn't.
It didn't ruin the magic.
No, it was actually very fun.
Okay. What's the best thing to do at Disney World?
Oh, well, it depends on what you like. If you're a Star Wars fan, Galaxy's Edge for sure.
Okay.
It's the coolest place. You feel like you're in Star Wars.
All right.
If you're not, I like a lot of things that are there.
Would you go right now?
Oh, yeah. I'm going in January.
So you're kind of a Disney adult.
A little bit, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, not quite.
Does it bug you now to have to pay?
Not really, because I'm not working there anymore. So I understand that I'm not, and I'm okay that I'm not working there anymore.
Do you have a special interest? Do you have a special interest and love for the people who work there?
Yes, I understand what they're going through and what they deal with on a daily basis. So yeah. And I have a lot of friends that still work there.
Do you give them knowing glances? With a little nod. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes. Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I went twice last year because my friends work there and so they could get me into the parks for free. And I was like, I was in your spot. I understand.
Yeah. Well, working with the public is always hard.
Yeah,
no matter where you do it and how you do it, it's not easy. Service industry is a difficult job.
Yeah. Disney's just a glorified customer service job.
Yeah.
Which is fine.
Yeah. It's a customer service job while you wear a Halloween costume.
Essentially. And the uniform we had to wear was bad. I looked like I was going bowling.
What was your uniform?
The shirt we had to wear was a dark gold and maroon striped polo that looked like a bowling shirt, and then navy either pants or shorts.
Nice. Do they give you all the clothes that you need?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. But it's really hard to find your sizes because there's a trillion people that work there.
Yeah, I bet. And then now you work at Harvest.
And then, I work at Harvest. I came back from Disney and was unemployed for a really long time. So I did DoorDash and Uber Eats.
You did what?
DoorDash and Uber Eats and Shipt, which is like a grocery shopping.
Is one of those better than the other? DoorDash or Uber Eats?
They're about the same. I just did them both for more income.
Okay. At the same time.
Mm-hmm, sometimes it'd be in the apps at the same time, yeah.
Okay, what's the weirdest thing that you saw through DoorDash or Uber Eats?
Gosh, I delivered to an apartment once, and they were nudists.
Well.
Yeah. I didn't know until they opened the door.
What kind of food do they eat? Do nudists eat?
McDonald's. Yep.
Oh.
I was like,
I wouldn't have seen that coming. I thought for sure you were going to say some sort of vegan thing.
No. It was just McDonald's.
But just
that's
McDonald's.
Why I didn't see it coming either. I'll tell you what, okay.
When I'm naked, nothing quite like a Big Mac. That's
yeah.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, so I had to, my mom did Uber Eats, or she did DoorDash at the same time that I was doing it, and I had to call her and be like, if you ever get an order for this place, don't take it.
Don't take the order.
Don't take it.
You can choose to take an order or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. You can accept it or not accept it.
All right. Did you like working it as DoorDash Uber? It wasn't that big a deal?
It doesn't make a lot of money, no. But it was my only option.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it's kind of always available type thing. You know what I mean?
So if I need like, you know, want to make some extra cash on like the weekends when I'm not here.
Yeah.
I will.
You'll still do it?
Mm-hmm. Sometimes. Not all the time.
You got to let me know when you're doing it because I'm going to get you order. I'm going to order some stuff so you can deliver it to my house.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I don't think, I've never used, I think I used DoorDash once, never Uber Eats.
Okay.
But I don't, I know people who use it all the time, but for me, I don't know.
I don't know how people use it all the time.
Yeah.
The fees alone.
Yeah, I'm like, always like, isn't that part of the point of going out to the place and getting the food?
Kind of, yeah.
Anyway. Seriously, doesn't McDonald's taste different if you get it delivered to your house?
Yeah, because it's cold.
Yeah, and the fries don't last. And so I just, it's not a thing.
Also, you got to use the McDonald's app. Oh, yeah. So then you get the points.
I got it.
Yeah.
All right. That's a lot of work.
Yeah.
That's, you could write a book on jobs. on.
I've been told.
You think your jobs are weird. Here's mine. Which was the best one that you've done? And the answer is Harvest Bible Chapel. Just kidding. What is the best one you did? Like when you look back on, is it the winery?
When I like, look back on it. Because I was going to say, my job right now, I love.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think. I mean, Disney was great, but probably the winery, because I worked with my mom.
Oh, that's
so
nice.
So we did events together a lot, so that was really fun.
That's great. Worst one?
Ooh, the barbecue place. I hated that job. I hated it.
Well, how long did you stay?
I was there for 2 months, and then I got the call that I had gotten the job as the receptionist here, and I said, bye.
Did you take your like pig hat and throw it down? I am done with this place.
My hat did. It was a visor and it had a pig on it. Yeah.
I bet it did.
It was something.
I don't think I've ever been to a barbecue place where they don't have a pig visor or something like that. Where are you from? Are you from Chicago? Is this Chicagoland?
Yeah, from Chicagoland. I grew up in Bartlett, which is about 30 minutes from the Rolling Meadows campus.
All right. And what was your family like?
Brothers,
sisters?
I have three siblings. I have a twin sister, a younger sister, and a younger brother.
You're a twin.
I am a twin. We don't look anything alike.
So they call that, is that fraternal? Fraternal,
yeah.
But she's a girl.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So.
Are people think you're lying when you say that you're twins?
For a really long time. They thought our youth pastor growing up didn't believe us for like 2 years until he met my mom and was like, are they telling the truth?
Yeah.
And she was like, yeah, they're twins.
Are you older or younger?
I'm older by 3 minutes.
All right. Big sister.
Yep.
And where are you in the pecking order when it comes to all your family?
The oldest.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Like by minutes.
Yep.
The oldest.
Yep. And I am the oldest child. My sister was definitely more middle child, which was hilarious because then we had a younger sister who was also very middle child.
And you were in charge?
I tried to be.
Okay. What's the age difference between you guys?
About 2 years.
Well, there's between. 3 minutes and then.
Yeah. And then about 2 years between all of us.
Oh, okay.
So.
That's pretty regular.
Yeah. My brother was a surprise.
Okay.
Which was hilarious. And they were like, oh, a boy. Okay, cool. Yeah. What do we do with him?
Exactly.
I love my brother though.
Oh, that's great. You grew up in a home that was, had a Christian background?
Yeah. I grew up in the church. My parents actually are first generation believers. They both accepted Christ while they were engaged, if I remember correctly. So grew up in church. We went to a small church by our house growing up until about six.
What kind of church?
Non-denominational.
Okay.
Just small. But it was very like small church vibes where, you know, everybody knew each other.
Yeah.
There was five kids my age.
Oh, yeah.
Including me and my sister.
Oh, so three other than your...
Yeah.
The two of you guys.
Yeah, and four of us were girls, and there was one boy.
Oh.
Yeah.
Either he thought that was amazing or hated it.
I think a little bit of both.
Okay.
So we were all friends, but...
That's good.
We then started coming to Harvest when I was in sixth or seventh grade.
Okay.
So I've been coming here for quite a bit.
How many years is that?
I just did the math on it, and it's, I think it was like 16 years.
Wow. That's a good long time.
Mm-hmm. It's been fun.
That's
fun
great.
That I work here now too.
Did you go to Bartlett High School?
I was homeschooled.
Oh.
Yep.
Homeschooled.
Yeah. I should have gone. I would have gone to Bartlett.
Did you
High
like
school.
Homeschool?
I did because.
What about it did you find really enjoyable? And what part, I mean, other than the, I get the whole like, hey, you wake up kind of when you want sort of thing yeah. and you do the work. But is there anything else besides that, that you're like, actually, I really love this part of it.
Yes. I was going to say, I was a very lazy kid, so I did really enjoy waking up whenever I wanted, but, it allowed me to explore my interests, beyond what, like if I would have gone to high school would have allowed me to do. So I love to bake. So I actually got school credit for all of the baking that I did because there was one holiday season that I was up every single night until like 4 a.m. just making bread.
What's your best baking? What is it? Like if you were going to go into a baking competition tomorrow and everyone was bringing their number one, their, you know, their top string, first string recruit, what are you?
Well, I do sell macarons. So
you do what?
Macarons, you know, little French cookies. I sell them.
So, you sell them?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's a job.
Yeah. I forgot about that. I just do a lot of
things. Now, how do you
things.
Sell them?
Just if people want them for things.
So oh, like so it's like an order thing. So mm-hmm. what would somebody order them for?
I've done some for bridal showers, birthday parties, just holidays. I sold them at the women's conference last year. Last year.
That's why you're here. Just to further your macaron business.
Yeah, you caught me.
Okay.
So probably those.
Okay.
Or a pie.
Okay, like a fruit pie.
Maybe. I'm trying to think of, yeah, probably a fruit pie.
Okay.
I just really like pie. So yeah. then well, being able doesn't? To bake, exactly.
The devil doesn't.
You're correct.
That's the
Amen.
Only person who doesn't like pie.
Yeah,
devil and his minions.
Amen. Yeah. but yeah, probably fruit pie.
Okay.
I made a blueberry pie over the summer. That was a pretty big hit.
Nice.
I really like making apple pie.
Okay.
So.
And you've chosen not to make any of this for your fellow workers at Harvest.
Well, we're getting into the holidays, so just wait. Patience. It's a virtue.
Well, just say I like blueberry pie. Okay. So you bake?
Yes.
What other things did you do when you were at school that you were able to, like, further, what other interests?
I like to read, so I would do a lot of reading. But like,
what would you read? What are your?
I was a big like dystopian fantasy kid. Ooh. So like, I read The Hunger Games, Divergent, a lot of those books.
What's the best one that you've read? If you're going to give a recommendation to somebody about young adult fiction, you're going to read it. What do you want? What?
I mean, I think that everyone should read The Hunger Games. I think those books are so fun. They're definitely different reading them as an adult. I just reread all of them.
Oh, why?
There's just a lot of like teenagers murdering each other. That's like yeah. the premise of them.
It is.
And you don't really realize that when you're a teenager, you're like, oh yeah, these are like adults. And then you're an adult reading it and you're like, these are children. Oh no. So, yeah. But I think that they're great books and very well written. I don't think anybody should read the Divergent series. It's just a bad series.
Okay.
So I would definitely not recommend that one. And it's not bad, isn't like there's bad stuff in it. It's just, it doesn't end well.
Oh, okay.
I think it's a waste of time.
Okay.
But
not like Harry Potter or anything like that.
Oh, Harry Potter for sure.
Okay.
Yeah. I was trying to go through I read a lot of series, but I read a lot more as an adult. So I'm trying to think of like,
what's the best book you've ever read?
Redeeming Love by Francine Rivers.
Francine Rivers.
Yeah. That's the only Francine Rivers book I've ever read, but I reread that book every single year.
Do you?
I love it.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Those of you don't know, Francine Rivers she basically takes like kind of the biblical world and she talks about characters in it.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a lot of creativity in it, but they might cross paths with biblical characters or yeah. they might be biblical characters or something like that. But she does a lot of really good like research into it and tries her best to kind of say this would life would be like if you were if you were a friend of Mary and watched this whole thing transpire. So
Redeeming Love is based on the book of Hosea.
Yeah.
So and the main character, his name is Michael Hosea.
Yeah.
So it very much is like a, okay, I know what this is about, but it's beautifully written and it takes place in like the old timey West.
Okay.
Like the gold rush.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Oh, good. That's lovely. For those of you out there looking for a thing, I'm just telling you that, yeah, most guys I know probably don't read Francine Rivers, but that's okay. If you like Francine Rivers, go for it. Sounds good to me.
I have read a lot of fantasy. Yeah. So, you know.
Dragons and stuff like that.
I love dragons. I think they're so fun.
Nothing like a dead dragon.
Well, I would like them to be alive, but.
For a little bit, until they get slain by a hobbit or something.
I am reading the Lord of the Rings books right now. Okay. So.
First time?
First time. Oh, yep.
Yeah. I've never been able to do the fantasy thing. It gets a little weird for me. It's always too long and too detailed. And yeah,
that's fair.
People like it a lot, but.
I have to listen to the audiobooks for the Lord of the Rings.
Oh, okay.
Because there's a lot of detail.
So is that a thing that you would do for, if somebody was going to give you a gift, they would give you a book.
Yeah.
That's your.
I would love a book or like sports memorabilia.
Okay.
Either one.
What sports memorabilia do you have?
Do I have?
Yes.
Oh, that would take too much time.
Okay. Just give me the top.
I have.
Best sports memorabilia.
I have a replica Anthony Rizzo World Series ring.
Ooh.
It's like an exact replica that a friend of mine just gave to me.
Nice.
He was like, here you go. And I was like, oh, okay. I have a Javi Baez signed baseball. That was really nice. I have a picture that is of Wrigley Field and has the World Series medallion that they only printed like so many of these and only made so many of these coins that I got. Oh, I worked at a sports apparel shop. Mm. That was another place that I worked. So I got one I worked there.
What's your best jersey?
I have a Lance Briggs jersey that I really like.
I don't even know who that is.
He's a former Chicago Bear.
Lance Briggs?
Yes.
All right.
He retired in like 2014, I want to say.
Yeah, I knew the Bears in the 80s.
Yep, that's fair.
And then
that was kind of the last time they were relevant.
And after that, I was like, yeah, I don't know.
That's very fair.
You guys had a lot of quarterbacks in there. at some point.
Yeah, we have had a lot of quarterbacks.
We still do. Uh-huh. It's actually kind of funny watching the Bears figure out quarterbacks.
Yeah.
They don't do real well with them. It's almost like they're like, you know what? We'll take that guy. And then that guy's the worst. Oh, no, we'll take this guy over here. No, that guy's awful too.
Yeah. And as a Bears fan, we do have a tendency to get really excited about a new quarterback. Mm. And they all kind of are the same, except for Caleb Williams. I will say he shows promise.
Well, he's
better than the other two that we've had.
I don't know.
We can agree.
The other guy goes to the Steelers and they win. But apparently, Caleb Williams is your hope and dream. That's all right.
Well, yeah.
He was at USC. I was watching. I'm a fan of the University of Washington. So I remember watching Caleb Williams in college. And anytime he played anybody good, he was terrible. But you guys, you know,
maybe
he's not what I think he is. And he'll eventually come right for you. Which would be fun.
Some sort of hope.
It would be fun if the Bears got good, because then people would be excited and stuff instead of just shamed by the idea that they have this team in their city that's so bad.
Yeah, it's super unfortunate. But I'm also a Blackhawks fan, and we were the worst in the league last year, which was.
Did you play any sports?
Yes, I did. I played softball for a couple years when I was a kid. I played basketball for 5 years.
Oh.
And then I was an all-competitive cheerleader.
You were not.
Uh-huh. I was. So please don't sound so surprised about that.
Okay. Now this opens up an avenue of questions that I need to know.
Yeah.
All right. Could you teach cheer?
Probably.
What would you teach somebody if they were going to learn cheer? What's the order of things that you learn? Do you know, like in basketball, you have to teach people a basic skills?
Yeah.
Dribbling. Shooting, passing. What are the things in cheer that you have to learn?
It depends on what you're doing. So if you're like a team that's cheering for like a football team, so like recreational or for a high school, you have to learn like the cheers.
Yeah.
But for all competitive, there's a lot of skills involved. So tumbling, stunts.
Oh, so this is different. Mm-hmm. So when you weren't cheering for any other team.
No. So I did recreational cheer for 8 years. And then once I got to like eighth grade, I went to all competitive. And that is, there's no like actually cheering involved.
No, it's like choreographed dance flipping.
Yes, essentially.
Okay.
There's a bunch of components to it that you have to hit, but you have to hit it into an...
People who was lifted, or were you a lifter?
I was a lifter. I have been super tall since I was a kid. And so they were like, you're this spot. And I was like, yep.
Did you ever go one direction while everybody else was going the other?
No.
Never?
I was so scared of that. I was like, I have to be great at this, because I was so scared of being perceived by anyone that I was like, nope, follow the crowd.
Can you do a flip right now?
No.
No. Handspring.
I could probably, I haven't tried.
Cartwheel?
I could probably do a cartwheel, but I haven't tried in a really long time.
Okay. Why did you get involved with cheer?
My uncle was really involved in like the recreational football and cheer league when I was growing up. So when I reached the age that I could do it, he convinced my mom and my dad to put us in. And then I loved it. So I just continued.
What did you love about it?
I liked being on a team, and I liked the skills that I learned from it. I just had fun. And then once I got to all competitive, I liked how much I was able to like work out and how active I was. There were some frustrating aspects of it, as there are with any team, but I just enjoyed it. I thought it was really fun. But my identity was super wrapped up in that for a really long time. So
what does that mean?
It means that when I quit, I lost all sense of self. I had no idea what I was doing or who I was, because I wasn't really following the Lord then. So
you grew up in the church then?
Yes.
And I did. At what point did you just kind of just, was it always something that you just sort of did and assumed, or was there did you sort of just drift away for a while, or what happened?
I knew a lot. So it was just kind of something that I did, but I didn't realize that it was something that I just did. I was like, oh yeah, I'm a believer, but never really believed what I was learning, if that makes sense. I was a huge people pleaser as a kid. And so people would be like, you believe this, right? And I'd be like, oh yeah. And then I didn't understand anything. And so it took my senior year of high school, I had graduated, and I actually that summer was like, I don't think I believe this. I'd like said that to myself. However, earlier that year I had gotten accepted to a gap year Bible school.
What was that one?
Cape and Ray Bible School in England.
Yes. I went to the one in Austria.
Oh yeah.
Years ago.
Was it Bodensehof?
No, that's in Germany. Okay. It's called Tauernhof, but Cape and Ray Hall.
Yeah.
In England.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So it was just really funny that I wanted to go to England, but didn't really believe anything about the Bible, but I was going because my parents were like, you should go to a Bible school.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. And so it was the first one that I Googled. And then that's where I accepted Christ, which was hilarious.
Yeah. Well, it's quite an experience. I mean, Cape and Ray Hall is beautiful. It's in a castle. Yeah. And up in the Lakes District in England,
gorgeous.
Which is like rolling green hills. It's what you picture of kind of the, it's nearish to Scotland. It's kind of near Liverpool there.
Mm-hmm.
And so rolling green
hills
with sheep and
so many sheep,
stuff like that around.
I loved the sheep.
But you're out there kind of in the middle of what it feels like a little bit in the middle of nowhere, but there's massive castle there, and there's this Bible college that has, what, 100 students or so?
Yeah, when I was there, it was like 150-ish.
Yeah. Yeah, and lectures are in the big old hall and all sorts of stuff. And you found it to be something that really had an impact on you.
Oh, yeah. It was quite literally the year that saved my life. Mm. And it's funny because I went there and I was like, I'm never coming home. Like, I'm just going to do my thing. I'm going to do the Bible college thing for like a little bit. And then I'm just going to like just never come home. Which has a whole nother, there's like a ton of stuff behind that. But it was a week into being there that the Lord was like, haha, you thought.
Yeah.
And it was a very special moment that I had gotten to a point where I just like couldn't sing any of the worship songs we were singing at one of our night sessions. And I was like, huh, that's weird. Usually I can fake this. Mm. And then I went out and I was on like a stairwell and sitting under the stars because we were in the middle of nowhere. So it was like stars galore. And I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. Like, I don't want to be here. I don't want to be around. I'm a waste. This is like dumb. Like, God, if you're real, like, why am I here? Like, what is the point of this? And then I can't quite explain it, but I felt the Lord. And he was like, I'm here. Hey, like, it's your time. Like, follow me now. And I was like, oh, okay. Sure. Yeah. Oh, cool. And then it was like everything clicked.
That's great.
And then I had a whole year of like intensive Bible study.
Yeah.
To really like figure out the things that I had learned all my life, but never fully understood.
Yeah. That's great. And so when you came back, you didn't want to stay in Europe.
I did, but getting a visa to stay is super expensive.
Yeah, it is.
And so.
So you came back and, you know, what do you want to do when you grow up?
It's a great question. I have no idea. Every time that I thought I've had an idea, the Lord has brought me in a different direction.
How old are you now?
I'm 28.
Yeah.
So I thought I wanted to be in sports. That's part of what my major is from college. And
where'd you go to college?
I went to Columbia College in the city.
Yeah. It's arts.
Yeah. I actually started for music business. And then halfway through my freshman year, one of my mentors and my advisor was like, you should not do this. I was like, okay, well, what should I do? And they were like, you should do sports. You would like it so much more. I was like, okay. So then I switched and I was like, yeah, I do like this a lot more. Yeah. And I got all my jobs in the sports industry. And I was like, cool, this is what I want to do. And then I could not, when I graduated, I could not even get an interview. And the only door that had opened was the one for this job right now. And I was like,
well, it's good to know where you were the bottom of the barrel for you.
It's just, you know, the Lord pointed me in the right direction, but kind of had to kick me through the door. Cause I was like, I don't want to be in ministry. What do you mean?
Yeah.
No, not me. I want to be in sports. And it was the only door that had opened.
Yeah.
And I thought I was going to hate it and I love it.
And what do you do?
I am the children's ministry admin and then also have now started helping with some young adult stuff.
Yeah. But you enjoy the administrative work and you enjoy...
I like working with kids and I love working with my boss. I work with Hannah, who's one of my best friends.
Yeah.
And so that really just makes every day of work like so much more enjoyable.
Yeah. Hannah is the children's ministry director here at the Rolling Meadows campus. And she's delightful
job.
And also a massive sports fan.
Yes. We get along very well. Yeah. We also have very similar lives because she's also a twin and also was homeschooled.
Wow.
And also a sports fan. So
I love it.
Yeah.
Well, that's really great that you guys get to do it. You know, by the way, everybody who I ever talk to and mentions you in like the most positive way, just so you know that you're a real asset and your kindness is very appreciated by people around
Thank
here.
You.
Yeah.
I
mean, I've tried to find out really bad things about you. They're not forthcoming. So I'm kidding, by the way, for all of you. That's not at all the case.
Oh, I'm just the worst. That's okay.
Yeah. But you're kind of figuring it out now.
Yeah.
Meaning that, you know, you had a direction and now you're kind of going in a different direction and realizing, oh, maybe this is something I would like to do.
Yeah. I'm kind of just going forward with my hands open and my heart open and like, okay, Lord, like whatever you have for me, like I'll walk through that door because I walked through this one and I love it. And it's been a huge blessing in my life. So why not do the same thing with the rest of my life?
Yeah. Well, and if not, you can always fall back on the coffee cart.
Oh, yes.
Or the hemp or the barbecue frying.
Yeah, I'll just go back to Disney
There's
World.
A lot of places that sell barbecues that you could go back in.
That's one I won't.
Disney World.
Yeah, I'll just go back to Disney.
Yeah. Are there people who've worked at Disney for a long, long time?
Yes. I worked with a couple that had been there for 50 years.
Wow.
Yeah. They had seen it go through so many changes and they loved it. I was like, good for you. They were retired. I was like, you're awesome.
That's great.
I don't want to be here in the summertime anymore.
That's
though.
Great. You know, there's a few Disney freaks here at Harvest.
There are,
and
yes.
I wouldn't be surprised if they end up working there.
I
keep thinking Larry Geisler is going to end up like planning a church at Disney World.
I could see
for
that.
For the cast.
He's actually one of the people I'm going on the trip with.
I bet he
in
is.
In January.
That'll be a lot of fun.
It's going to be so much fun.
That'll be fun. What you guys should do is you should like post your strategy for Disney World because I've been told that Larry, he does consulting.
He does.
For this.
Yeah.
Like if you ever want to go to Disney World, he will get you, he will tell you what order to do the things in order to maximize your day.
Him and I have had conversations about it. We're like, hey, we should push everybody to do this because it's going to be so much better.
Nice. So. Nice. Well, I hope your strategy works out and that people
so
will really love it. Okay. Well, Orlando's usually a nice place to be in January.
That's what I've heard. I have never been there in January, so.
Well, it's not it's not quite as much like hell as it usually is. So.
I mean, I worked there. It was April to October.
Yeah, it's pretty cold. It was pretty hot.
So bad.
Pretty hot in the summer.
August in Florida is the worst. I don't know why anybody lives there then.
Yeah.
It was so hot.
Especially, in, I mean, it's kind of when the hurricanes start. It's usually right around there. So.
Yeah, I was there during Hurricane Ian.
And? Was it really horrible?
I slept through most of it. So okay. I ran around in the rain a little bit, so I could say that I ran around in a hurricane with a friend of mine. But it was, I mean, we were in Orlando, so nothing bad hit us.
So I'll finish with this. Okay. I often make dumb decisions because my attitude is always like, how hard could it be? I took a bunch of kids to Southern Mexico once and we went there. And on this particular trip, we ended up going into a region that was known for all the rebels.
But I was
like, I mean, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Well, actually the rebels decided that the town I was in, that we were in, that they were going to drive around in the backs of their trucks and shoot their guns in the middle of the air and try to find people to kidnap. So we had to keep all these kids inside.
Yeah.
And so while we're there, the people we were with were like, we should just go to the beach then because they're not going to steal you off the beach. Oh. The problem was it was terrible weather. And I was like, this is horrible weather, you know, wind, really bad wind. And the surf was so high. And these kids are like, we're going in the surf. And I'm like, well, okay. But it's a really bad surf. And nobody else was on the beach.
Oh.
Nobody. I couldn't believe it. Anyway.
Well, if the weather was
this
bad.
Guy came up to me halfway through and he started speaking Spanish. And I'm like, I don't know what you're saying. So I got the guy over who spoke Spanish and English. And the guy was asking me, why are all the white kids swimming in the hurricane? And I said, what hurricane? And he said, this is a hurricane. And this is of course before they had internet. No. I mean, this is in the 90s. And I found out that indeed we were in a hurricane. And that's why the surf was so high. And that's why the wind was gusting at ridiculous. I didn't know what the speeds were, but it was ridiculous speeds.
Nobody else
was on the beach. And there was a line of people who were kind of near the beach who were watching us. Mexican people who were shaking their heads and being like, you are the dumbest people. Anyway, I come back and I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I did this. This is the same trip, by the way, that somehow I thought that they could all get into Mexico with their birth certificates instead of a passport. Oh. And I didn't have the anyway, Delta Airlines finally said, well, you guys can travel there and they might kick you out. But we went to Mexico and they were like, yeah, whatever, come on in. So let's just say I am not a great planner about things at all. And so we went through this whole thing. We come back. And this one kid, Donald, you know, you come back to the church and they want to have the announcement or the, you know, detail of the trip. So they give us like 20 minutes and this kid, Donald, gets up and he regales people with stories of scorpions that were in the bunks, which they were, of not barely being able to get into the country, of the rebels shooting guns in these small towns.
No.
In this small town and swimming in a hurricane. And let's just say my father-in-law was the pastor of the church. Yeah. And he called me into his office a little later and said, Jeff, I've had, let's just say there's been some complaints.
Oh, wow. I wonder why.
Yeah. A bunch of the parents were like, where did this guy take our kids? And it was at that point I realized I probably shouldn't be a youth pastor at all.
Well, you live and you learn.
Don't ask me to plan stuff is what I'm trying to tell you.
Good to know.
Because my attitude is, it'll work out.
Well.
It did work out. We all got back.
I mean, yeah, you made it safely. It's fine. Yeah. Every kid made it back.
Yeah, and they had a story to tell.
Yeah, it was the best.
Thanks so much for talking to me, Sam.
Thanks for having me.
It's such a pleasure to have you at the church, and I'm thankful that God's using you in the way he has. And
thank you.
God bless Cape Verde, by the way. It's a really important part of my life as well. Yeah. It's kind of similar situation, but fantastic to see the Lord using it. Anyway, thanks so much for being here, and for the rest of you, we'll talk to you next time.